Okay, all right. Sure. The company founded in 98 and it's headquartered in San Jose, California. And we have 169 million active accounts. It's not like, you know, registered and then people don't use it. It's really, really, you know, they're using day to day for transacting online and then offline in stores. And 203 markets, right? 100 plus currencies. And also we processed 400 billion payments last year alone. And we moved 235 billion you know, exchange hands through PayPal platform. So it's really, really mission critical. When that comes to money, it's very, very critical in terms of security or compliance and stuff like that. It's very, very important for us to, you know, keep our, you know, business as it is while you innovate on something else like, you know, cloud or maybe PaaS, IaaS, doesn't matter, and you can't disturb the existing business, right? So so when we put together the, you know, the design goals for the cloud platform 3.5 years back, it's not that actually we didn't have the cloud. We had multiple generations of the cloud, right, in the name of automation. Like, you know, we brought in, you know, a bunch of tools from the vendors, and we had it in our data center. You name it, we had, you know, different type of, you know, tools all over the place, right? But, you know, they were not meeting, you know, some of our organization goals that we had in mind, like, you know, developer agility, right? So scale as you grow. Instead of, you know, buying, you know, multiple tools and then, hey, I use this tool for, you know, scaling to some extent. Now it's not working out. You bring in, you know, some other automation tool. But the problem with that, actually, you have to change the other layers above the infrastructure. So that we wanted to completely eliminate, you know, those kind of things. So basically, you know, we put together, you know, some design goals, design principles before even we get started with, you know, what you want to do for the cloud platform engineering. It's not only going to work for a year, it will at least work for 5 to 10 years, right? So we took, you know, three main, you know, goals, the design goals, right? A platform to collaborate internally and externally. What do you mean by internally and externally? So let me talk about internally, right? So PayPal is a size of company close to, you know, 15,000 to 18,000 employees we have in our company, and then it's still growing at a lot of acquisitions is coming into our company. And how we are going to be keeping all of these developers and different, you know, partners and the operations teams or networking team, our, you know, storage team, we wanted to have some collaboration in collaboration platform so that actually we go and innovate together rather than being, hey, storage team, I got some cool technology, this is how I'm going to be rolling out, you know, you guys integrate with me. It is not going to work because a larger organization, actually everybody wants to innovate at the same time, everybody wants to do things their own. But we wanted to have a common platform so that actually we can collaborate better and then we could move faster. And what do you mean by externally? So it's not that I said we develop everything ourselves, right? We don't build switches and routers or firewalls or load balancers, right? So we wanted to partner with absolutely with, you know, all the vendors, right? But if you do everything your own internally, they don't actually know how you are automating all this, you know, different things in our data center. So what we did was, okay, is there anything that actually we can leverage so that, you know, they know actually what PayPal is using? And how I can integrate with those platforms so that actually, you know, PayPal doesn't care about actually what kind of capabilities that I have in the devices. I find a way to expose it as an API so that just, you know, PayPal can use it. So before you build your product, make sure that actually it's compatible with some APIs. It works for, you know, PayPal, right? They test everything and then ship the product as well as the integration points also. So we wanted to have that as well as part of our design goal. So the next one is very critical as well, right? So we had automation team. It's not that actually we didn't have automation team. We had cloud platform team, right? Okay, great. Okay, we built everything. Okay, a guy actually coming in. Okay, he got a vendor tool. And after some time, hey, I have the script. You have to put it in my framework. It executes. And it doesn't give you all the feedback loop that you wanted to have in terms of, you know, logging or maybe mining or, you know, if you wanted to have, you know, multiple executions parallelly or you want to scale out your control plane itself. So we didn't have a lot of flexibilities in the tools that we had it in the past, right? So we wanted to have an agility for the developers that we are going to provide from the cloud platform point of view. And they are going to benefit, okay? Infrastructure is exposed as a service, okay? They come in and then self-service compute APIs, storage APIs, load balancers, firewall, or whatever you name it in the data center, it's all being self-service through the API. So what about the cloud builder itself? He's screwed because all the hard work actually what he is doing, so he has to do it himself. Instead, actually, we wanted to have some lot of flexibility and agility for the developers itself. If you want to change, So to name one particular example, actually we ran through, right? So we wanted to filter, add more and more filters, right? Say for example, you know, if you want to distribute across, you know, multiple racks your VM, then how we are going to be doing that? If there is a vendor tool you are bringing in, so you have to expect them to provide that, you know, platform capability, and then go and add your, you know, features to that, rather than being actually just an insert and filter, and it makes sure that actually nothing is breaking. So you can introduce, you know, more and more of that actually as a pluggable fashion. So we wanted to have that agility as well for the developers, right? And very important thing is actually well-defined cloud APIs, right? So we built, you know, multiple generations of cloud within PayPal, and then we had, you know, SOAP APIs, REST APIs, CLI, different version, right? Great. But what happens is, you know, we are only few architects actually. We used to sit together, you know, fight each other or brainstorm, and then come out saying that, hey, this is the API. Okay, for creating the VM, you pass a bunch of attributes, and you're going to get a VM after that, right? But over the period of time, what happened, actually, we had only limited set of knowledge, and there are, you know, bunch of, you know, other people outside of our organization, they're very smart. We wanted to leverage them, right? And when we designed, you know, some of these APIs, we have to iterate more and more, and then we always had gaps in terms of, you know, the APIs, API capabilities, and then, you know, attributes. So we wanted to have a well-defined API, and it is working for packet compatible, as well as in the current generation, actually, you know, who are actually going to be using the new capabilities, it is not going to break. So we wanted to definitely have a, you know, well-defined cloud APIs. So when we put together all those things, what happened was, hey, okay, there is no one in the world is going to, so they have the product for that. And we took our existing products as well. At the same time, we were looking for some new options as well in 2012, July, right? And we did, you know, POCs with, you know, CloudStack, OpenStack, and then Eucalyptus, and our own, you know, existing tools that we got in our data centers. I don't want to name what are they, but actually you name it, actually we got it in our data center, right? And we carefully reviewed each one of them, right? We took more than 2 months to identify, okay, you put together design goals, but you have this, but you wanted to go there. Okay, what will it help for you? Then what happened was, during this, you know, evaluation period of 2 months with POCs and stuff like that, okay, so OpenStack stood out. Even though actually we started very, very early in SX timeframe, but we decided to go with that because the community is really, really faster, and then a lot of, you know, vendors, you know, they're coming in, and also in the foundation was formed. Even though actually OpenStack is there from, you know, 2010, we were looking at every year, actually we evaluate our technology of, you know, a technology audit within the company, and then we'll compare with, you know, other competitors, and then technology market, where we are in terms of the technology company when compared with, you know, other financial companies or maybe e-commerce companies, right? And we do that every year, but 2012 when we did that, hey, okay, OpenStack is there, but there is no foundation. We don't want to, you know, just jump in and then get burnt in that. So OpenStack Foundation also formed, I think, 6 months before actually when we started. Right, that was the right time, and then we decided to go with that. So if you look at, you know, some background about, you know, PayPal Cloud, specifically in OpenStack Cloud that I'm talking about, actually, we started in 2012 with one engineer, and since we invested a hell lot of money in our existing infrastructure and the existing platform tools, you know, there's no one going to sign up for something new because, you know, everybody comes in, they talk about something, after that actually they leave. So basically, you know, what we did was actually we got only one engineer, that's me, and then 16 decommissioned engineers, decommissioned servers that we got it from one of our data center, right? So we put it into the lab, and then we went with the POC and then went to executive team and stuff like that, and then, you know, a lot of back and forth, and I'll go through actually, you know, where we started, because there I have, you know, a very brief slide actually, right? So today, it is one of the world's largest OpenStack private cloud. I could probably say that, right? It is not that actually we are running only, you know, QA or dev workloads just for fun. It's really, really mission critical. The first slide I talked about, right? It's a $245 billion money that we moved through this platform, right? It's not a dollar or two, right? And without compromising our availability, security, and then reliability, at the same time, you know, more importantly, you know, without disturbing existing business, right? So it's real, we moved it, right? And you know, we started with, you know, 16 decommissioned servers. Actually, they're supposed to, you know, go out of our data center, but today actually we are running 8,000 plus hypervisors, right? And 400,000 plus cores. I don't know actually who is largest, you know, after this. I think Walmart has, you know, closer to this, I believe, in private cloud, right? And number of VMs, 82,000 plus, and block storage, 2 petabyte. So if you talk about actually object storage, we just got started with that, right? So PayPal doesn't have a lot of object storage requirements here. They are all still coming in, and we are building out an object storage cluster also bigger and bigger, and there are going to be a lot more use cases going forward, right? And the number of availability zones, 10 plus availability zones, and largest AZ we built during last summer, it is 2500 hypervisors, right? This is the largest one we have built so far, right? With three different cells. So what we did in a business enablement, hey, they're all great technologies, you brought in OpenStack, not nice, right? So we are hosting 100% of PayPal traffic, right? Except databases and messaging, right? That's 3.5 years of journey. And it's powering 100% of platform as a service, right? A layer on top of IIS. And DevQA, mergers and acquisitions, whatever bring in our company, actually, use the same platform, because if they have some colos or whatever, we put them into the roadmap and then we migrate them into our data centers, right, to save cost and for a lot of other benefits, right, network monitoring and stuff like that. So, and also we deployed SDN. SDN was also very, fancy word and then, overused word in the industry now. And we deployed it in 2013. And also we ran production workload also there. So when you say production workload, it's not like all the production workloads that we are running in there. We carefully choose, pick and choose, because you wanted to be at the bleeding edge, but you don't want to burn yourself in terms of availability, security that we always talk about, right? And also the reliability of our business itself. So, okay, this is where actually we are today. Okay, and also we clearly put together a vision. Everything starts with the vision, and it's not that actually we are very different from them, right? So the vision is very simple. Actually, I talked about that 3.5 years back when we started OpenStack in other conferences, and also we talked about Vancouver and all the other summits as well. It's nothing changed. It remains as it is, right? So provide a platform that enables agility, availability, and innovation for the company. As a cloud platform, this is what actually we wanted to have it. So if you look at the risk payments, wallet, mobile, ad, there are social payment. There are a lot of other products also we have within PayPal. And all of them are going to be using this, just one platform. Platform as a service, and then behind it actually, infrastructure as a service. And if you could look at, any data center products actually below, we just want to abstract them out, using the infrastructure as a service API, right? This was the vision. And also, we wanted to have the configuration management systems that, goes through all the way from PaaS to IIS, so that actually you can correlate things together, so that actually something going wrong in your switches or routers, you know exactly actually what is going to get impacted in your application, right? So we wanted to have the entire correlation with your data center, your applications, everything. So we definitely badly need a configuration management system. And also the monitoring, remediation, alerting, whatever actually you need to run a large scale infrastructure, right? So you cannot just like that, throw them out because you are bringing something new, right? And one good thing actually what we had in our infrastructure, right? So we had very, very experienced, professionals, because the cloud could be, the new cloud vision could be new in 2012, but this company founded in 98, remember, right? So we had a lot of best practices we used to follow in terms of running this largest, one of the large infrastructure. So we got all this, different talents in the company, and then we made sure that actually we are going to be working for the next generation cloud platform, right? So we leveraged them, in full. So there is no compromise in that, right? And if you look at, so this is what the vision we had, but the software comes and go, we bring in one particular tool, you use, Puppet sometimes, and then bring in Chef, or maybe, you bring in Ansible or whatever, right? So if you look at, the infrastructure as a service, we completely standardized on, this one, Nova, Neutron, Cinder. That's the only API that we provide, right? And if you look at a platform as a service, so that's very, very critical. So it needs to manage the entire application lifecycle management for our developers, so that actually they don't care about, hey, how my application is going to get into the production, and how it is going to be monitored, how I'm going to be rolling out the new code. So there is a complete automation from the developer box to the production. Remember, so before this platform, we had multiple different cloud footprint where somebody is running on another stack in DevQA, somebody will be running on LNP in a different stack, and the bare metal servers and production is completely different. But there was always complaint, hey, it worked in my LNP environment, but in production actually I get more latency for it introduces some more latency for my application. So if you're not going to be running the same platform across the board all the way from developer box to the production, of course, you will have differences. What we did was, the same API, it serves all different varieties of workload, right? Dev, QA, LNP, prod, or any mergers and acquisitions that we are bringing into our in our company, right? So that really, really, you know, saved a lot of time, troubleshooting time, specifically when you talk about, you know, performance of your application itself. Because if you talk about payments, right, it's very, very critical. See, you can't stand in the queue to pay your payment, you know, for a minute. It has to be within a second or two or three second maximum, right? Otherwise, you are going to get pissed off. It doesn't mean that actually you bring in on a cloud platform, but your transaction time got increased by 10 seconds. That is completely unacceptable, right? So it really solved a lot of problem for, you know, the developers where, hey, it worked in my dev box. Hey, I also tested in my QA. Also, I tested my LNP, but I don't know what the operations do, but it is not running, it's not working in production. Only the number of VMs and then the pool size difference. But otherwise, you know, the same set of infrastructure we run everywhere across, you know, even the dev VMs also in the same cloud, in the same kind of flavor they use, whatever they use in production, right? So it's nothing different. So if you look at, you know, the configuration management system, actually CMS, actually we wrote internally. So it has, you know, it's called, you know, CMDB. CMDB is nothing but CMDB, and it's being open sourced as well. You could try it out. And also the open source side, actually we are using Puppet Salt and then Ansible, and we use it for, you know, different, you know, purposes. So I don't think actually I can go through all the different use cases where you use Puppet, where we use Salt, and where we use Ansible. And if you look at, you know, a bunch of other tools we wrote on top of that to manage this cloud itself, right? A lot of homegrown tools, right? To run 10 plus availability zones on the largest OpenStack, you know, AZ with 2500 hypervisors, things will go wrong. It's infrastructure. Network will break, or maybe, you know, there is a switch will go down, or even we, you know, one of the core router also went down, both active and standby. So how are you going to be, you know, remediating all of them so that actually, you know, your business not get impacted? So we wrote, you know, a bunch of tools, and you know, I think one or two in this, you know, already open sourced, and we will open source others as well. And the open source side, actually, we use, you know, Elasticsearch, Logstash, Kibana, and Zabbix for monitoring, right? So if we look at, you know, the layer above it, actually, platform as a service, right? That also, you know, comes and goes, because if you look at, you know, our platform as a service that we have it in PayPal to deploy the code all the way, you know, from developer box to production through the self-service manner, we cannot compromise on release management and then change management, because thousands of developers, you want to roll out your code to the production. But if you just say, hey, I check it into the code GitHub, hey, Docker is great, but how do you know that actually it's not going to impact, you know, others? Okay, you test it, but still you want to have a lot of change management and all those things so that actually if something goes wrong, you know for sure actually what was rolled in, right? And rolled out to the site. And you have to go back and then immediately roll back all of them, right? So these things actually we cannot definitely compromise on all of that. So, and you know, we also, you know, pick and choose the technologies based on, you know, what is coming into the market. We will make sure that actually those APIs also very, very clearly defined for platform as a service also, right? So if you go back to that, right? So this is where we started, okay? This was in the lab, okay? It was unused compute nodes that we got it from the lab, and we talked about actually what where we are today. Okay, so this is the whole journey of actually where we started, okay? I think, you know, there are a bunch of, you know, targets, and then we went through, you know, multiple phases, clear execution of, hey, this is where we started, and we didn't just stop it, actually. We just keep going, and whenever we, you know, ran into issues, we will make sure that we reiterate, and then we consistently keep going rather than being, hey, we stuck, but we are going back and then, you know, revisiting our vision itself that we put it together 2.5 years back. So it is still continuing. Actually, we started in 2012 August. If you look at actually the POC was completed in the lab, and then we moved to production. So one thing actually we did something different is we put our, you know, OpenStack cloud in the production directly. Right, a lot of people think about, okay, I roll it out on DevQA, and then I promote it to production. But we took in a different approach. When we looked at, you know, the infrastructure issues, what we have seen is the QA is the one of the, you know, most challenging one, because the rate of change is so much, but production is more controlled. So there were a lot of discussions went around that, hey, we are saying that actually we are going to be in production, but hey, how guarantee is going to be that? But we took, you know, a lot of, you know, issues that we ran into for the last 1 year, 2 years in terms of managing the stages QA environment. It was more complex than the production. So for me, actually, you know, if you talk about the cloud APIs itself, right? Once you built the VM, then you, once you provision the pool to the load balance and stuff like that, it is continue to just exit as it is most of the time in production, unless otherwise we add more compute nodes and stuff like that. You add to the load balance, it's going to work as it is. But in QA, it's every time actually the developer checks in the code, it completely changes. And the rewiring also happens, you know, very often, right, in the QA environment. But production is much more stable. And let me, you know, jump into the deployment architecture. I'm sure, okay, there are a lot of information, 3.5 years, I'm really, really running fast, but, you know, if you want to catch up on me, actually, I'm going to be sharing my email ID also, you could send, you know, your specific question, and I'm happy to, you know, answer for that. And I shared the same slide, and, you know, Vancouver also. It, nothing changed, right? It is very similar to what AWS or maybe what GCE has in terms of, you know, the regions, availability zone, and within the availability zone, actually, we run multiple cells as well for scaling purpose. So here, the very interesting thing is, okay, your availability zone is your fault domain. What does it mean, right? If something goes wrong in your core routers, okay, your application should not get impacted at any cost, right? But it is not the case in, you know, traditional data centers, right? Okay, you run 10 VMs. For a particular application or 20 VMs or whatever, if two or three of them going down, it's a big deal for an application owner. Hey, my application pool capacity went down 30%. Now, I don't care, actually, you have to bring it back. But, okay, even if own availability zone goes down, how are you going to making sure that, okay, you spin up some more VMs, you roll up the code, and you're going to be, you know, bringing back the, you know, same capacity for your application pool. So how many applications are ready for that, first of all? Okay, how many applications are, you know, they are going through the platform as a service? Because remember, platform as a service also evolving in every company, like, you know, we are not very different from that too, right? A lot of companies still might be going through the same, you know, old, you know, way of, you know, deploying applications to the productions, you know, going through, you know, multiple phases, right? And if, unless otherwise you have a click of a button, actually you have spin up 10 VMs or 20 VMs or whatever, actually you got affected in one particular availability zone, and you add another availability zone, and you deploy the code, bring it back online, that is peak traffic, for example, if you're talking about in US, anywhere, you know, night, afternoon, 11 o'clock, I think morning 11 o'clock to 2 o'clock for any e-commerce company, or maybe payment company also the same. Okay, what about actually if one of the core router went down in one of the availability zone, how you are going to be taking the traffic in other availability zone within a minute or two, because every second, every minute counts for in terms of revenue, right? How many applications are ready for that? So when we built all this, we were carefully, you know, choosing, hey, what's your availability zone? Your availability zone is at least, you know, 15 racks, okay? Entire 15 racks goes down, it's not get impacted for, your application cannot get impacted. But a lot of people, they've said, it's going to be impossible to do that. Then, okay, we didn't want to wait for, you know, all this, you know, other components to move into the pass, and then they go through, you know, auto scaling and stuff like that. So we wanted to move the needle. At, you know, when IIS grows, we want, you know, every legacy infrastructure, bare metal, and then, you know, legacy, you know, the cloud, we wanted to move into that. So what we did was actually, you know, initially, even though actually we talk about AZ as a fault domain today, we said actually you have a rack, maybe the half rack, the network fault domain and the top half rack, switch level itself actually it's in fault domains. Whenever you create an, you know, VM for a particular project, we will make sure that it is going to distribute it across, you know, multiple racks and then multiple hypervisors as well. But it's completely anti-cloud pattern. How? So one hypervisor goes down, you have five VMs in that particular hypervisor, you're screwed, right? But ideally it should not. But, you know, we are at an AZ level today, but earlier it is not. So this is, again, the same thing within an AZ actually what we run. We have, you know, typical data center architecture where we have the internet, and then you come to your core routers, and then, of course, you know, we have DDoS protection in the edges. So I'm not mentioning all of those here. And you come to aggregation layer, and then in access switch is nothing but your, you know, top of rack switch, and then racks. If you look at, you know, very interesting, the last, you know, last portion of the slide itself, then, you have your, you know, control plane and then data plane, and then VMs, and where you run your SDN controllers, and then SDN gateways, LBs, and firewall. If you look at this whole thing, right, it's a very, very important slide. So earlier, we used to have our infrastructure racks separately. You buy one or two racks, you put all your controllers, everything there. What about actually you need to scale yourself up, right? You have to scale out your controllers as well. Then you can't wait for one more rack to come in and then, you know, go and, you know, spin off all your control plane. So this was the older architecture we had. It actually, we started with that. But currently, actually, you know, we also run in the same infrastructure where all our, you know, customers also, internal customers also being having their own VMs. But they're all running in a different network, right? They're completely isolated. They're all different firewalls in between. And also, you know, I'm going to be talking about the VPC in the next thing. So this is definitely, you know, solved a lot of problem for us in terms of, you know, making sure that as a cloud control plane itself, you know, scaling out well. And there is only one rack actually still we cannot move away from that. That is the reason actually we wanted to run our SDN gateways, load balancers, and then firewalls, everything into the VM itself. So that, you know, say if you want to add capacity, this particular zone, okay, you want to add more load balancers. What about actually if you don't have a space for that in those racks, right? You cannot just like that, you know, buy another rack, that you may not have power there. Or maybe, you know, where are you going to be putting together, right? So the goal is to, you know, have kind of NFV functions, move all the load balancers and firewalls into, you know, the same cloud racks itself. So that actually you are moving away from some, you know, pits kind of, you know, racks into your, you know, cattle kind of racks. So that actually, you know, you can scale out your firewalls and the load balancers also going forward. And it's going to be virtualized as well, right? So, and also, you know, one thing actually very important for us is actually, you know, instead of building, you know, multiple clouds for, you know, varieties of workloads or varieties of, you know, different type of workloads like, you know, QA and, you know, LNP, or maybe, you know, you might be having some external cloud that is, you know, completely, you know, some kind of, you know, blog post or whatever that, you know, people want to deploy it outside. And, you know, you might have, you know, a lot of, you know, security zoning within your data center itself for compliance reasons. Actually, you cannot put everything into the web layer. You have to protect somewhere in the compliance layer and stuff like that. So, in typically, people, what they do is actually they have, you know, they build in a multiple, you know, cloud. What we did was actually we introduced, you know, VPC. That it's very much similar to, you know, what, you know, other public cloud providers have. So VPC is the one actually it's logically, you know, separating it out, you know, different type of, you know, security zoning for us. For example, in the same cloud, we run DevQA as well as production or LNP or EXT or whatever, but there is a clear boundary is being defined for that. What they could do, what they cannot do, and what image each VPC could use, and including, you know, your DNS zones. What DNS zones a particular particular tenant could create a VM or maybe the load balancer VIP and stuff like that, the DNS names. So all this being are logically grouped, and they're all constructed under, you know, bunch of attributes for the VPC. We clearly define VPC attributes, and then, you know, add it to the, you know, particular admin project. Because and you know, whenever there is a project created, we'll make sure that we inherit all those attributes for that particular, you know, project in a particular VPC, right? So VPC is a collection of OpenStack tenants again, right? OpenStack projects, and it is a security zone we talked about. Okay, who could talk where, and where they can access what? So basically, you clearly define the security zoning and then introduce, you know, different type of technologies to isolate this traffic itself. If it is a newer data center, we have VRFs. If it is an older data center where you don't have, you know, all the, you know, fancy, you know, newer generation of networking gears. So we use, you know, VLANs, and then we use, you know, firewalls in between to separate out the traffic. But the construct, you know, stays as it is. Even though actually we use different technologies to, you know, realize it, but the construct stays as it is for the tenant point of view. Right, and also the keystone changes to make it happen because of, you know, there is no VPC concepts. Actually, we modified, you know, keystone, introduced, you know, a lot of, you know, modules for that to make it happen. And also, you know, a VPC in the virtual private cloud world, it's a single large virtual router, right? When you use your overlay, we have a single large, you know, router so that actually they route each other. They have their own, you know, router for a particular, you know, VPC. But if you are going to be using, you know, VRF, the next generation one, actually, if you are going to be running on, you know, the bridge network, actually, we use, you know, VRFs to separate the traffic, right? And VPC model introduces scale is used because specifically, you know, when you go to overlay, right? So if your VPC has, you know, 2,000 hypervisors, okay? So whether one logical router could handle that much of a traffic, right? So if you're talking about, you know, 2,000 hypervisors, even if you put, you know, 10 to 15 VMs each, it's going to be 20,000 VMs, right? If it is going to be active, you know, standby router, okay, how soon the traffic could fail over if something happens to your active router, right? So those money flows. How seamless it is going to be if you're taking mission critical, you know, payments, right? That's where actually we are very careful in, okay, selecting the size of that particular logical router itself so that we don't impact much, and we are evolving as we grow. And we run, and also at the same time, we don't want to say, hey, I don't want to run my production on overlays, because that's the ultimate goal that we wanted to have. But we'll carefully choose the workload that we wanted to run overlay, what we wanted to run on bridge, right? So VP size level, over a period of time, and the network gears, okay, that we talked about, and challenges in managing, 10 plus availability zones, right? Okay, thousands of services across multiple data centers. What do you mean by that? Okay, we have controller services, Nova, Neutron, and then every hypervisor run its own, Nova service as well. How are we going to be, making sure that all of them running all the time, so that actually your cloud health and then cloud resources are being up to date, whatever you are going to be running. So we ran into so many issues in terms of, keeping up, all these services running. If something goes wrong, how fast actually you can detect, and how fast actually you could remediate them. Say suppose, Nova service went down, and you are trying to, spin up a VM. Even though you have a capacity, you are not going to get a VM. But that's not the, best place you wanted to be in. So what kind of automation you have so that actually constantly monitor, constantly auto-remediate, so that actually, you run your cloud at scale all the time without interruption to the end users, right? So gigabytes of logs, I'm sure, okay? If you are running OpenStack, you know how much log that you will get every day. So, okay, detecting is one thing. Actually, your Nova service went down, you have Zabbix monitoring, it is going to alert. But how quickly actually you can identify what's the root cause, right? So thousands of log file. How you are going to be making sure that actually this is what it is triggering, that particular outage, right? So we have to drill down so many logs, and then you have to do a lot of stuff to do that, because it's not going to be simple. Right, we have to aggregate everywhere and then push it to the logstash, and then Elk stack, and then do a lot of mining to identify that. We put a lot of effort for that to collect all these logs and then mine them, right? And many moving parts, okay, in the cloud. It's not like a database application. Hey, this is my application. I have middle layer and the database. Okay, if the data is not getting saved, or maybe one of your database attributes is not getting updated, you exactly know actually what is not happening. You can go to your log file. There could be a stack trace. You can figure it out. But in this corporate network and the data center, there are multiple backbone, multiple different people are responsible for different parts of the infrastructure. And backbone network, LDAP infrastructure, and you have DNS infrastructure, anything go wrong, right? And how we are going to be making sure that all of them are going to be working so that your cloud also works. Sometimes actually, your DNS entry is not getting resolved, but it will become cloud problem. Even though actually you're not directly responsible for that particular zone, or maybe whoever is not replicating from your production network into the car, because completely two different infrastructure, right? So somebody is connecting to your dev box, and their DNS entry is not getting resolved. Maybe the DNS entry got missed when they sync from one particular infrastructure to the other infrastructure. There are multiple moving parts, but this will become a problem. How we are going to be solving them, and what kind of partnership that you are establishing within the same organization, so that actually we all have clear SLAs defined between each services, so that actually you satisfy your own customers as well, right? But for the end user, it doesn't matter actually who you are partnering with, but cloud needs to work for all the different components. And then network infrastructure differences. Over the period of time, as I mentioned, actually this infrastructure is built more than 10, 15 years. And it is being retrofitted every 3 years, 4 years, whenever we decommission our infrastructure for tech refresh. But 4 years you have to still live with it. The older generations of the gear, actually you may not upgrade, you might not be able to upgrade some of the firmware or whatever, right? So still you have to deal with them. But it will definitely affect your availability of your cloud APIs itself. So network infrastructure changes, overall failure versus 1 or 2. Okay, this is very critical, right? So, okay, this is where actually I always talk about actually dev cloud is very complex than the production cloud. Say suppose you are a developer, you spin up a VM, you are doing some R&D work, or maybe you are developing or whatever, you save something local, but you don't use some volumes or whatever. But the hypervisor is going down, and for some reason, actually, you cannot recover back because the disk went bad or whatever, and you have to send it to RME, and then you have to re-image, then you lost your VM. Hey, cloud is broken, right? 100%. Okay, I got only one VM, that is completely gone. But in the production, actually, it's much more simpler. You have 100 VMs for your application, but 1 or 2 going down, it's not a big deal because they're all stateless. You spin up a VM, roll out the code, and add it to the load balancer, it's going to work. But the effort that you wanted to put, that VM, one VM not going down for that particular developer, it is a big deal, right? So we put a lot of effort when we rolled out our dev VPC, a lot of support we got it in, and we made sure that actually the hypervisor is not going down, and your hypervisor failure rate itself, it's not more than 2%. That's our internal goal that we had. But when we started, actually, it was our 5-6% because of the different generations of the hardware that we have in the infrastructure, right? And how fast actually you can upgrade all the BIOS version and then and firmware and all those things so that actually your hypervisors actually keep it healthy all the time, right? And the global keystone, and this one actually, since we have 10 plus availability zone, we don't want to have every developers going there, hey, this is my keystone 1 for this particular availability zone, keystone 2 for another one, keystone 10 for another 10th availability zone. So we introduced global keystone. So there's only one endpoint. The customer comes in and then he get token, and that is usable for across all the AZs, right? We rolled out global keystone also. Otherwise, it's going to be a nightmare for the end users who are going to be integrating with cloud APIs. And sync issues between AZs and cells. Hey, great. We got cells. We introduced cells because we want to scale out our RabbitMQ infrastructure and stuff like that. But introduced a lot of other problems as well. There were sync issues between availability zones to cells and availability zones. So we have to deal with bunch of bugs to make it work. And it took us some time to figure out actually, hey, you're showing actually 15,000 VMs in this particular AZ, but actually the all three cells are showing 15,000 VMs, but AZ level we have only 14,000 plus or something, right? Then later on we realized actually there was some sync issues going on, but when we rolled it out, we didn't do that much of a scale testing, right? We didn't have that big of infrastructure to simulate as well, right? And firewall between control plane and hypervisors. This is another big thing. So since PayPal is a compliance company, there are a lot of security involved in it. So there is a firewall in between your control plane and then your hypervisors. Okay, your Nova is running, but there is a stateful firewall. If there is no interaction between your hypervisor or a controller, it is going to shut down, right? And whenever there is, the Nova is done with, it changes, and if it's going to be, putting back some, messages to the queue is sitting in the control plane, different infrastructure completely, different VPC, and the message is not going to reach. So how are you going to making sure that, okay, the state is up to date in the Nova database? So there are some, bugs. There were some bugs actually in the Havana version. Actually, it got resolved in Kilo, and then Kilo upgrade actually resolving a lot of problems. But we had workaround for that actually. We got to patch that. It took very, very long time for us to figure out actually, why. Okay, everything becomes a RabbitMQ issue. It's not a RabbitMQ issue actually, right? It is infrastructure issue. Because I know people are exchanging messages, million plus messages every second in RabbitMQ. It's not a RabbitMQ issue. So how we use RabbitMQ, right? And we talked about generations of hardware, firmware version, BIOS difference. I'll tell you a classic issue that we ran into recently. Okay, our hypervisor rate of failure was 5-6%. Why is that? Because there was older for hardware, and then firmware itself, okay, there was a buggy. Okay, even though the temperature is not reaching the threshold, it is bringing down your hypervisors very badly, right? Then we have to upgrade. So how are you going to be upgrading thousands of hypervisors overnight? It's going to be impossible. So, but you have to deal with that when you talk about your cloud at scale, and then you want to making sure that actually you have your hypervisors are healthy all the time, because it's taking production. Then you can't just like that overnight you cannot upgrade all of them, right? And then config drip management. I'm sure actually you guys might be going through this as well. Okay, if you are running thousands of hypervisors, you are expected to have config dripped. Okay, so you roll out Puppet, the hypervisors might have been down. Since we are not running Puppet automatically, then you will have difference in the in the config file. But how are you going to making sure that okay the config is going to be up to date when the hypervisors comes back? Right, so we have to do some automations around it so that actually we have all our configs also up to date. And capacity management, cloud back office. Okay, hey, great. So cloud, you are saying cloud is unlimited, but we say we don't have capacity for 32 core VM. How are you going to be doing this? Oh man. Oh, okay. Give me 3 months, and I'm going to buy a capacity and then add it to the data center. Right, but people say hey. But public cloud is not that way. But actually, why are you taking so much time? Then we did a lot of automation to minimizing this, the whole life cycle of bringing in a new capacity and added to the cloud itself. We did bunch of automation still going on, and instead of having 4 to 6 weeks of capacity add process, actually we are bringing down to weeks, right? So we did a lot of automation for that. So any cloud provider, if you're operating at that scale with mission critical workloads running, and if you want to add 20%, 30% of capacity year over year for your data center, absolutely you need to have all this automation. And challenges, you know, DevQA, actually we talked about bunch of things. I wanted to cover some specific areas as well. So unpredictable API usage pattern, people do crazy things in the DevQA, a single point of failure for a single VM, we talked about that, and variety of workloads. Okay, it's not like in a web and made or maybe some database applications. People bring in some Kafka cluster and they just go and run Cassandra or something else, and they do a lot of LNP testing as well in the dev cloud. But they sometimes actually DDoS over load balancers and then firewalls as well. So how much of data they're pushing through the firewall between different VPCs, it is going to choke your firewalls also. So you cannot predict that. But production actually absolutely know actually what your traffic pattern is, right? And then you have connectivity requirements. Hey, I got this dev cloud, but I wanted to add something else in somewhere else actually in the infrastructure. And you have to find a way to help them in terms of how you are going to unblock them. Right, and patching the VMs. Okay, there is a lot of security patching is coming in. How fast actually you can patch the dev VMs where you don't have the access, and they just change the root password, and then they're not even using the keys or whatever. How are you going to be patching them? Right. So as an infrastructure provider, actually in the private cloud, public cloud actually cloud provider they don't care, but in the private cloud you are responsible for both tenants as well as for the cloud infrastructure itself. You got to patch your hypervisors and the tenant VM as well, right? And enforcing the discipline. Around among thousands of developers, right? So with that, okay, I think we had a lot of information that we wanted to share in last 35 minutes, but I don't know how much time we got for Q&A. I'm happy to answer some of your questions, and if you have more, again, you can send me an email. And if you want to be part of this, actually want to learn more and more, we are hiring as well, right? So any questions or too much of information you guys want to digest before asking the question?